when I get to where I need to get to. Because I'm going to take my time. Is that all right? I got my glasses on, so I can't really see what time it is. So, we'll just be done when we get done. Is that all right? I ain't that slow. I know y'all ready to go, so it's all right. I ain't going to be long, but I will be strong. I appreciate your prayers and the loss of my mother. It has been it has been one of the most strange times of my life. And I was telling the young man last night, we were talking, I said, I can't explain it. I don't know why I have so much peace. But that passage that says and talks about a peace that passes understanding has been speaking into my spirit. And we went into the funeral, and everybody was standing around and looking. And I said, y'all can look all you want to, but we finna have church up in here. And I thank God for Jerome and John and Jasmine coming to support us. And we just had a celebration. We had a celebration. That's what life is supposed to be about. It's a celebration. And we need to, you know, we sorrow. We gonna miss her. Amen. But she lived her life for the Lord. So we have a celebration. And I just pray that when we all leave here, we can celebrate because we die in the Lord. Amen. So we appreciate your prayers and your support. And Southside, you're just home to me. When Pooh asked me to come, this all hadn't happened. I said, yeah, I want to come. I want to be there. And then he called me back last week after he heard of mom's passing. He said, you know, we got somebody else. And I said, I'm still coming. Now, if it was anyplace else, I may not go. But I'll go to Southside because y'all family.
All right.
And so if I start preaching, the Holy Ghost get hold of me and I can't finish, it's all right because we family.
Amen.
Amen. So I said, Pooh, I'll be there. And I'm glad I came because I pray that I bless the young adults, but I know they bless me. And it's been therapeutic for me to be here and to share with people that love the Lord. To be surrounded by your spiritual family is better than being surrounded by your physical family. So I thank God for you, for your prayers, and for your love. Let's go to the Word. Y'all ready for a Word this morning? We're going to go to the book of 2 Kings. And I pray that you all are good Sunday school students. And I don't need to read the whole chapter.
All right,
let's read the chapter. Beginning at verse number one. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse number 1. It came to pass, when the Lord was about to take up Elijah into heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal. Then Elijah said to Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me on to Bethel.
All right.
But Elisha said, as the Lord lives, and as your soul lives, I will not leave you. So they went down to Bethel.
Yeah.
Now the sons of the prophets who were at Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, do you know that the Lord will take away your master from over you today? And he said, yes, I know. Keep silent. Then Elijah said to Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me on to Jericho.
All right.
But he said, as the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you. So they came to Jericho. Now the sons of the prophets who were at Jericho came to Elisha and said to him, do you know that the Lord will take away your master from over you today? So he answered, yes, I know. Keep silent. Then Elijah said to him, stay here, please, for the Lord has sent me on to the Jordan. But he said, as the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you.
All right.
So the two of them went on, and 50 men of the sons of the prophets went and stood facing them at a distance while the two of them stood by the Jordan. Now Elijah took his mantle, rolled it up, and struck the water. And it was divided this way and that so that the two of them crossed over on dry ground.
All right.
So it was when they had crossed over that Elijah said to Elisha, ask, what may I do for you before I am taken away from you? Mm-hmm. Elisha said, please let a double portion of your spirit be upon me.
All
So he said, you have asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if you see me when I am taken from you, it shall be so for you. But if not, it shall not be so. Then it happened as they continued on and talked that suddenly a chariot of fire appeared with horses of fire and separated the two of them. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it. And he cried out, my father, the chariot of Israel and his horsemen. So he saw him no more. And he took hold of his own clothes and tore them into two pieces. He also took up the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him, and he went back and stood by the bank of the Jordan. Then he took the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and struck the water and said, where is the Lord God of Elijah? When it also struck the water, it was divided this way and that, and Elisha crossed over. Now when the sons of the prophets who were from Jericho saw him, they said, the spirit of Elijah rests on Elisha. All right, all right. And they came to meet him and bowed to the ground before him. This morning, I want to encourage us and challenge us from the subject, the transfer of power.
All right, all right.
The transfer of power. Can we be real this morning?
Come on, do it.
You sure? Y'all good with that? I was going to do it anyway, but here's the reality. The struggle that we have in the church, well, let me take a step back. Last night as I talked to the young men, we talked about the anointing. Amen? We talked about the anointing that God has on our lives. And that each one of us has been chosen by God for a specific and a special purpose. So the place I need to start, because this morning is really a continuation of what I discussed with them last night in terms of the anointing. And the problem is that we believe the only person in the church that is anointed is the preacher.
All right, all right.
And we don't understand that if you've been chosen by God, yes, and if you have given your life to the Lord, the anointing is on you.
Oh, yeah.
Now, what you do with the anointing, that's your decision. Yeah. But the anointing is on your life.
Yeah.
If you're teaching Sunday school, the anointing is on you.
Yeah.
If you're leading songs, the anointing is on you.
Right.
If you read the scripture, the anointing is on you. If you clean the building, the anointing is on you. And too often, we believe that the anointing is only for spectacular things. And that's true. It is just for spectacular things. And we just don't understand that it's spectacular to clean the building right. It's spectacular to read scripture right. It's spectacular to pray and to touch the feet of God. We don't understand what the anointing truly is. So how can you transfer the power when you don't understand your anointing? Because a transfer of a power deals with the transfer of anointing. I need us to understand from this story of Elijah and Elisha what really is happening.
Okay,
as we understand how God intends for transitions and transfers to happen in the church.
Right.
And the problem is that too often we act like the church belongs to us. And we act like we're going to live forever. And we act like there's never going to be a time when somebody else is going to have to lead the church. But the reality is that you will not always be here. And somebody needs to be prepared to do what you do. And the time to be prepared is now. Not when you're gone and now you take someone who is unqualified and not anointed to step into a role because ain't nobody else to do it. Because we did not plan and we did not prepare as God's people, but we lived like we thought we were going to be here forever. Shame on us to treat the house of God and God's business like it belongs to us.
All right.
And the truth is, I'm looking at you, and the older generation is saying, well, they're not ready. Amen.
All right.
We can't pass nothing on to them. They're not ready. And the younger generation is looking at you and saying, when are you going to get out of the way?
Yeah.
All right, come on.
And you know what? Can I be real?
Yeah.
You even sit divided.
Yeah.
All right. Amen.
Yeah.
They over here. Y'all over there. Okay. Is that too real for y'all? We ain't gonna get nowhere if we can't be real about where we are. Y'all all right?
Yeah.
All right.
So there is already a natural, even from the physical, there's a natural division because the music they listen to is not the music we listen to.
All right.
We listen to Bobby Blue Bland and B.B. King. Y'all right? And the closest we might get to them is some of us listen to Tupac. But we ain't gonna tell them that. We ain't gonna tell them we listen to Tupac. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Some of y'all really smile when I start talking about Tupac. Hello? There's a natural division that happens just because their interests are different from ours and their taste is different from ours. And that age automatically creates a divide. But we have to learn that when we share Jesus, it needs to overcome what separates us. Hello? Because what we've been through, they're going through. So who better to coach them and to counsel them and to guide them on the struggles of life than us? We have bad credit. So we can help them understand how to avoid getting into a situation and having bad credit. Stop acting like you ain't. Come on, y'all. We need to be real. See, the first problem is we done got so holy. I need y'all to say amen because they ain't saying nothing. We done got so holy, so saved, and so sanctified that we act like we ain't never messed up. Like we ain't never been to the club. Things. We forget those things like we ain't never did it. They know you've been to the club. They see how you move in church and know you didn't learn that move in church. Hey.
All right, Dad. All right.
So I'm up here singing about the Lord and He's good, and you back there talking about. You ain't learned that from Jesus. Like we've never been where they are. So when you talk about a transfer of power, we first have to find the common ground. And that ought to be Jesus. There are some things I want us to learn from Elisha and Elijah that I pray will help us. And it's all about the anointing. So the first thing I need you to understand is God never intended for anyone who is not anointed to be in power. Now, when you have those in power who do not have the anointing, you create a challenge for the anointing to come into power. Because when the unanointed have been leading God's people, they're used to being led unanointed. And then when the anointed comes into power, you now have a group of people who don't even recognize the anointed because they ain't seen it. Now, I praise God that you don't have that problem here. But some of your cousins in some other cities, praise the Lord. Hello. But you have to understand, and that's what I need to tell the young people. You have anointed leaders. You have anointed folks who protect the church.
Amen.
The anointing demands that you protect the church. And for that reason, you can't just hand the power to anybody. So the transfer of power can't happen to somebody who sings loud and proud on Sunday, but does... And the problem, now I'm going to talk to y'all because they ain't going to say amen. The problem with Snapchat and Instagram and all these platforms. platforms is, we at least had enough sense to not be proud of our sin. And we hid it, even though God saw it. It wasn't all out there. But now, I know all your business because you put it on social media. So I see what you're doing Monday through Saturday. Then you want me to hand over the keys to... You want me to just hand over and say, I'm going to make you the Sunday school teacher. I'm going to make you the praise leader. I'm going to let you stand in the pulpit and preach, but I've been watching your Snapchat all week. And it ain't said Jesus.
All right.
Hello? So you automatically... Are they still look all right? Are y'all okay? Okay.
You okay?
So you have to understand. You see, here's the thing. When we stand before God, we will be held accountable for how we have handled kingdom business. And that means that those who are currently in positions of a power cannot hand over anything to those who are not anointed. You can't. If you can't manage your checkbook, why would we give you the church finances? Look over there. I'm not looking over there. Hello? If you're not faithful in your giving, I didn't look at nobody on this. If you're not faithful in your giving, why would we let you manage the church's money? If you can't get to church on time, I'm not looking. If you can't get to church on time, why would we put you over Sunday school when we gotta try to find you so we can start on time because you ain't never here? The anointing ain't late. The anointing makes a sacrifice that says, although I could be running late, I'm gonna get up early because I got God's business to handle. All right, now y'all not even looking right. Hello? And too often we make church stuff so personal that we've lost our mind. You can't tell me what to do. Can't, no, I'm grown. I'm 21 times two. You don't tell me nothing. You gonna lose your soul with that attitude. And the Lord knows ain't no anointing on your life. Hello? And then the problem is they see us act this way. Like we grown and can't nobody tell us nothing. And we are at least receive instruction from God. From the word of God. From studying the word of God. And we don't want to receive instruction from nobody because we think we grown. So you bring along another generation that has been taught not to listen. Do what you want to do. It's your thing. Don't listen to the preacher. Don't listen to the deacons. Don't listen to the elders. Because can't nobody tell you nothing. You're going to bust the gates of hell wide open. Hello? This is not about you. You know what? I'm going to say this because you need to hear it. I'm so tired of pity parties in the church. I'm so tired of everybody, oh, woe is me, my life is so bad. I ain't got no job. I ain't got no money. We all got struggles. We all got issues. They ain't the same, but we all got problems. You want to sit here and run down your list of problems? I got a list just as long as yours. I ain't got time for no pity party. I got too much work to do for the kingdom. Y'all not looking right. And when we sit around and just whine and complain all the time, the first problem is do something. You complain because you ain't got no job and you ain't put in no applications.
All right.
Hello? And too often we sit back like the church ought to take care of us. And we ought to take care of the church. Now, hard times can hit anybody. Struggles can hit anybody. But you know what? Hold your head up, square your shoulders, and walk with God. I don't serve a God who ain't got power. He can get me out of anything. And he told me he's not going to put more on me than I can handle. So I'm going to get to my points, for I'll be here all day. Elijah and Elisha, what do we see? The first thing I need you to see is, all we're talking about is the anointed. So we need to look at the anointed's attitude.
All right.
The anointed's attitude. And let's look at Elisha. His attitude was, I'm not going to miss my blessing. So when you look at Elisha, every time Elijah told him to stay, Elisha said, no, I'm going with you. Every time Elijah said, just stay here, no, he said, I'm going with you. In the midst of distractions, he's going with the anointed. The first thing that happens in the transfer of power is the anointed walk with the anointed. Now, Elijah and Elisha didn't just meet yesterday. They've been walking together for a long time. And Elisha has been learning from Elijah. He's been watching. He's been seeing what Elijah does. He's been seeing the power of God. So the first thing that you need to do, if power is going to be transferred to you, is you need to be walking with the anointed that are in power. You build a relationship. And you connect to those who have the anointing. And you have to have an attitude of, I'm going to get my blessing.
All right.
I'm going to learn what I need to learn. You want to learn the church's finances and handle money? Who does it now?
All right.
Y'all scared? Who handle money now? Anybody in church now? I ain't saying y'all right. It's okay. It's okay. They nervous, ain't they? They nervous about that. Pray for them, Doc. So let me ask you, what makes sense? If you have the gift and the anointing of managing money, who should you be walking with? The anointed that are doing it now. Where are the Sunday school teachers? Raise your hand. Sunday school teachers. Now, if you're going to be a Sunday school teacher and that's your anointing, you need to be walking with the Sunday school teachers who are handling business now. Are y'all with me? You don't just step into something and don't know nothing about it. And the problem is, we sit around and wait for folks to die, and then we want the position. When you should have been in training while they were still working. Now, I can't be trained if you won't train me. So that means that the anointed have to train the anointed. Hello? And it doesn't matter who you are. You clean the building, you need to be training somebody to clean the building. You cut the grass, you need to be training somebody to cut the grass. Why do we take God's business so carelessly? Like it's not so important that somebody needs to be in training to do it, because you ain't going to be here forever. Then something happens to you and we scrambling trying to figure out, well, what did he do? How did he do it? Nobody knows. He had all the knowledge. He never shared it with anybody else. Shame on you. Shame on you. That we didn't have the vision to know that the anointed trained the anointed. So the anointed have to have an attitude that I'm going to get my blessing because I'm going to get trained. Hello? Second thing, look at the anointed's audience. Now, don't y'all miss this. Look at the anointed's audience. So here they are. They go to Gilgal. They go to Bethel. They go to Jericho. And the prophets, because these are the cities of the prophets. The prophets, who are the anointed, tell Elisha, you do know that God gonna take Elijah from you today, right?
All right.
And what did Elisha say? Shut up.
All right.
What did he say?
All right.
He said, shut up. I know. Shut up.
Okay.
Let me tell you something. The last thing I'm worried about when the anointing is on my life, is your feelings. Y'all don't like that.
All right.
Y'all too sensitive. Don't be no punk. See, if you worry about people's feelings, then you mess up your anointing. Because people are too fickle. Y'all know y'all. Yeah. You sing this week, you won't sing next week.
All right.
You come this week, you may not come next week. And now I'm going to base my ministry around somebody who is as inconsistent as you are. You mess up my anointing. My direction has to come from God. So I have to understand that the anointed's audience is sometimes an audience that you got to say, shut up, in a nice way. Yeah, be quiet. Shh. However y'all want to do it, but don't talk to me. Because right now I'm walking in the anointing. And if Elisha would have stopped, and argued with the prophets, Elijah would have left him. How many times have you missed your blessing because you were arguing with unspiritual people and the anointed just walked away? Because there are some conversations you don't have when the anointing is on your life. Why am I trying to explain my anointing to you and you ain't anointed? You'll never understand it. You'll never get it. You'll never ever comprehend. So I'm not going to waste my time with that conversation. I'm going to keep my eyes on the anointed who's training me.
All right, Santa.
And you have to understand that sometimes in your audience, there will be people who will distract you, who will get you off track, who will throw all kinds of mess your way, so you lose sight of where you ought to be. You have to understand the audience that we have to deal with sometimes. Next thing I want you to see is the anointed's aspiration. Look at the anointed's aspiration. Elijah says, what can I do for you? And Elisha says, I want a double portion of what you got. He said, I want a double portion of what you got. Because his aspiration was to give God more glory than Elijah did. Elisha wanted to be better. He wanted to take God's business farther. And so when you have the anointing on you, you recognize that I want everything you got plus more. Because I want to give God all the glory that I can. It ain't for you. It ain't about you. It's about God's glory. And you're looking and you're saying, I'm watching Brother Malone and what he did and praise God for him. Lord, give me a double portion. So I can take the kingdom further. And I can do, Lord, and you know what? This is what I love about it. He didn't say give me double portion of a spirit. He said give me double portion of Elijah's spirit. Because of the respect that he had for the anointing on Elijah's life. And because of the respect that you ought to have for those who have come before you, you ought to be saying, Lord, give me a double portion of what Brother Malone got. Y'all ain't hearing me this morning. When you see somebody do it right, why do you need to reinvent the wheel? You don't need to reinvent the wheel. You just need to make it roll faster and farther. Lord, y'all are missing your shout this morning. God does not intend for Southside to stay here the next 10 years and be doing what y'all are doing today. God intends for some power to be transferred from the anointed to the anointed so they can have a vision that we don't even comprehend. Snapchat, y'all don't even know what it is. But while we're sitting here having church, when the anointing rests on them, worship services all over their Snapchat.
All right.
Because they take the anointing that's on us and they get a double portion.
Yeah.
And they do with it what we would never think to do with it.
Yeah.
What we've done is great. But in the church too often, we rest on what we've done, not what we can do. So when the anointed have a vision, the anointed in training needs to embrace the vision and say, what can I do to help us get there? Y'all all right?
You preach a lot.
And the truth is, when we have a, this is something we're losing. When we have a respect for God's anointed, we'll be better people. I never knew what my parents were doing when I was being raised. But as I was being raised, I never called any adult by their first name. I didn't understand that. It was a little thing to me. And one day I was just like, okay, all right, we'll do that. And I was probably 16. And you know, you start feeling yourself and you start thinking you're pretty smart. And I was smart. I mean, absolutely. But you know, you think you all that. And one Sunday we're sitting in the meeting and I said, that's a good idea, Thomas. And when we got in the car, my dad said, don't ever do that again. I didn't know what he was talking about. What are you talking about? He said, you call Brother Timur Thomas. And I said, now y'all need to hear me. I said, you call him Thomas. And my dad said, absolutely. And you ain't me. You haven't earned the right. You haven't earned the right. You ain't taken enough stripes. You ain't had enough beatings for the kingdom to call him Thomas. That's Brother Timur. And don't ever forget it. And I never, he said it and I went on and whatever, it ain't no big deal. But later on in life I realized there's certain things you just don't do out of respect for God's anointing.
All right.
And you never grow to a point that you disrespect God's anointing. Ever, never. You respect who God put where he put them.
All right.
Do you remember the story of David and Saul?
Yes. Yeah.
And everything that Saul did to David? And what did David say? I will not put my hands on God's anointing.
All right.
He had opportunity, but he wouldn't do it. Because there are some things that God does and we don't touch it.
All right.
And I'm telling you, you all have to have a healthy respect for what those that have come before us have done. When we got our church building in Springfield, the bank said the church's credit ain't good enough. And Thomas Timur and Howard Anderson and Larry Johnson went to the bank and signed their name, used their credit, put everything on the line themselves so the church could get a building. And you gonna have the nerve to disrespect people that have given up everything for building and furthering the kingdom. Now what God intends to happen is for us to respect that anointing, for us to acknowledge that anointing, and for us to get a double portion of their spirit. A spirit that says, well, Lord, I understand that you managing my finances anyway. So it ain't no, well, my dad, you know, I remember sitting at home like with my eyes wide open, like I was watching a boxing fight.
All right.
And dad came home and said, Polly, I'm gonna sign so the church can get a building. And I'm like, oh, she finna snap. She finna snap. You know what she said? That's fine, baby.
All right.
I'm like, where's the fight? But there's nothing more powerful than a man who's anointed, married to a woman who's anointed.
Amen.
Yeah, come on, I'm gonna help y'all. Y'all like talking about the women being anointed. Yeah, the women is anointed. And some of y'all men that know y'all ain't what you ought to be, but you are what you are because of the woman you got. Ought to say amen right now. Hello? You already double portion because he gave you a good help meet. Y'all ain't saying amen, y'all. I'm missing y'all blessing and a good meal today. You better say amen. Yeah, look at Pooh Pooh over there. He knows. Say it loud, Pooh. You learn it fast. The anointing demands that we respect what has been done. Not tear it down, not destroy it, but respect what has been done. And we ask for a double portion of that spirit so we can do even more. Y'all all right? Now the last thing I want you to see is the anointed's answer. Elijah asked for a double portion. Let's see the anointed's answer. So what did Elijah say? You asked the hard thing. You asked the hard thing.
Yeah.
But if you see, when God takes me, then you know you got it.
Wow.
What he really said was, you've asked a hard thing, and only God can give it to you. And the thing we have to understand when we are the anointed is, it ain't ours to give away. It ain't ours to give away. This thing belongs to God. This is God's business. It ain't ours to give away. It's not. And the problem we have is we have the anointing on us, and something happens, and we literally move the anointing to the side. You know how you say you lay your religion down? Yeah, you move the anointing to the side so you can do what you want to do. And we have to be careful that we always walk and stay in the anointing that God has placed on us. And when you do that, you realize that any power, anything you have, ain't yours to give away anyway. It belongs to God. Therefore, you're looking for those who have the anointing on them so you can say, Lord, grant a double portion to Pooh. Lord, grant a double portion to Jay. Y'all hearing me this morning? Because you know them, and you know their spirit, and you see the anointing on their life, and you can't hand anything to them that don't belong to you. But you can say, Lord, I see something in Jasmine. Give her a double portion. How often have you prayed as a church for those coming behind you that the Lord would give them a double portion of what you got? We too worried about our pension and our car payment and the struggles of life that we're losing sight of God's business. And if we just take care of his house, he'll take care of our house. Something I saw my parents that blew my mind. Every single year, one thing they did is they opened the checkbook and showed us the checkbook. And every year, when they budgeted, their giving went up. They may not have got a raise on the job. They may not have got nothing else. But they found a way for their giving to go up. Because they were trying to teach us, going to church and looking holy won't save you. Singing loud won't save you. Passing communion trays won't save you. God wants all of you. And when the anointing is on your life, the first thing you give him is your heart. And if you give him your heart, he got your money. Too many of us are trying to fake this thing and act like we so holy. And we haven't let the anointing of God touch our pocketbook. Y'all all right? Y'all don't look all right. God cannot do what you won't let him do. And when you limit him because you don't have enough faith, and you talk about their lack of faith. But what about your lack of faith? When you've been putting that same $50 in for the last 40 years. How y'all doing? They just hung up over there. Y'all doing all right? Everything okay over here? Because they hung up.
Yeah,
they hung up. They tore the cord out the wall. They disconnected the phone. They're done.
All right.
They don't want to talk to me no more. So when y'all get a chance, would y'all tell them that I said they need to stop putting in that same $50 they've been putting in for the last 40 years, and they're getting a brand new car every other year? Now, I'm not going to tell them because they done hung up, but y'all tell them when church is over. How in the world can you continue to have carnal blessings, but you refuse to do anything for the great God of heaven who gave it to you? Would y'all tell them that when y'all get a chance? Would y'all look at them how they look? Only one smiling is John. Huh? Now let me help you, because they see us. Now what am I doing driving a 2017 smoking clean honey gold Murano putting in $20 in church? My father taught me that the biggest payment I should ever make ought to be my offering. Not the house note, not the car note, but the largest payment that ought to come out of my checking account should be to the church. All right, so I'm back. Go back over there, y'all. Y'all don't want to hear this either? The whole church done hung up.
All right.
You know what? I need somebody who's got the anointing on them. Anybody got the anointing on them? What, didn't God say try him? Didn't he say try him? And what did he say? What are you going to do? Come on, brother, what are you going to do? Huh? He can't hold his seat because he done tried it. And you know that when you try God, he'll pour out a blessing that will make you lose your mind.
All right.
And we have to learn to trust God in every phase of our life. Y'all all right? That wasn't in the sermon. I don't know where that came from. That Holy Ghost, but y'all look like you needed it. I'm telling you. The one thing I don't want to happen is to stand before God and find out I got it all wrong.
All right.
Man. To stand before God, as arrogant as we come to church, we come in here so arrogant sometimes. And to stand before God, you know, I don't know how he's going to do it, but you know, he just calls and say, Desi Anderson, come on, you next. And I'm just going to walk up and be like, what up? Yeah, how you doing? Praise the Lord. Waiting on him to run down my list of accomplishments. Because we like people to give us accolades. We want him to run down the list of accomplishments. He just says, well, you know what, I'm not going to go down your list of accomplishments because you didn't make it anyway.
Come on.
So then I'm gonna turn around and say, okay, you got the wrong Desi Anderson. There's another one.
Yeah. All right.
No, I'm talking to you. You put in a lot of work. Did a whole lot of stuff. But you got it wrong.
All right.
Because you did what you wanted to do.
Yeah.
And you didn't hear my voice when I was telling you what to do. And you treated my kingdom like it was your kingdom. And you held on to the power like it was your power. And you wouldn't move out of the way so the anointing coming behind you could take the kingdom to the next level. And instead of asking for a double portion of what you had to go somebody else, you wanted to keep it all for yourself. Do you really think I'm letting you in here? Don't live this life and get it all wrong. We better learn how to truly be the anointed that know how to receive the power and know how to transfer the power. This morning, I pray that you go to the next level. I pray that you take what God has blessed this church with and you are blessed with so much talent. But I pray that you use it the way God would have you to use it. And you need to be in constant prayer that God will give you the wisdom and the guidance to know how to transfer kingdom business from anointed to anointed. I pray that we learn how to trust God and not lean on our own understanding. And I pray that we learn how to truly live for the Lord and not ourselves. And that we stop coming in here with an arrogant spirit like we've earned the right to come in here. And the same way that I didn't call Brother Tim or Thomas, there are some things that we should never say to God. Because you ain't earned the right. And we ought to come humble. We ought to come submissive. We ought to come knowing that no matter how much we do, we still don't deserve heaven. Never can earn it. Nothing you can do. And too many times we really look at what we do, and even though we don't verbalize it, we act like we've earned a seat in heaven. Our attitude says, I've earned a seat in heaven. Our arrogant tongue, you know, when you listen to people talk, it tells you more about them than anything in the world. And if you talk to a person long enough, they can only fake it for so long before the true colors come out. And that arrogance that they have to think that they've earned the right, that they ought to be sitting in heaven next to God because you've done so much for the church and the church can't function without you, I got news. If you die tomorrow, the church is going on. And forgive me for saying it, it might be better.
All right.
Because it's not about you. It's all about God and what we can do to bring him glory. How often do we come to church and we don't even say God?
All right.
Just in the prayer. Just if it happens to be in the song. We come here and talk about everything else.
Amen.
Because see, this is the only time we get the whole church together. So this is the time that we handle business that ought to be taken care of during the week. But we take the Lord's Day and do everything we can do, and we remove the anointing from ourselves because we're so worried about church business. This is the Lord's Day. We ought not be talking about nobody but the Lord. Nobody but the Lord. How would you feel on your birthday if all they did was talk about somebody else? Somebody else got all the presents. Somebody else got to blow out the candles on the cake. Somebody else got to cut the cake. Somebody else got the first slice. I'm going to be cussing on my birthday. It's my day. I won't hear nothing about John Malone on my birthday. Skip John. Skip him. And it wasn't his birthday. It's my birthday. It's about me. I want the presents. I want the gifts. I want the money. I want to blow out the candles. I want to cut the cake. But how do you think God feels when he comes in here on Sunday? We're going to be his day. And you blowing out the candles. You cutting the cake. You getting all the presents. And he don't get nothing. And I'm done. I'm gonna drop the mic, I don't wanna break it, man. And you can't do that at church, can you? Can you drop the mic at church?
No.
Praise the Lord. We thank God for the anointing that's on each of us. But it's time for us to remove ourselves and to put God first. And to take care of his business first. And for those of you who are sitting here, one of the things that came out as we talked about this retreat this weekend, these young adults, they need some support.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
They have some doubts. They have some fears. Right. They have some struggles about how to walk in the anointing. And we ought to be able to help them. Yeah. Amen?
Yeah.
They shouldn't be going through this alone. They opened up their hearts and they shared, you know, I would do that, but why would God use me? They feel like they're not worthy to be used. They feel like they're not qualified to be used. And they need to hear some of our testimonies of what we've done and where we've been and how God is using us. We need to let them see the value that they have and the worth that they bring to the kingdom and the fact that we need them to do God's business. And for those of us who are not walking the anointing and we know better, we need to do better. Yeah. We need to raise the standard on our own life. Yeah. And we need to do better. This morning, I'm asking you, I'm begging you, let this be a Sunday that Southside has a revival. Yeah. And you come together as one family, as the family of God. And those that have the anointing are saying to those who are walking into their anointing, I'm here to help you. I'm here to walk with you. I'm here to help you handle this transfer of power so you can be used for God, so you can get a double portion of what he gave us. We need to come together. And if you have a fear that you're just afraid to walk in that anointing, you need to lay that thing before the Lord and say, Lord, I need you to give me courage to be able to do what you called me to do. I need you to give me direction to be able to go where you want me to go. I need you to surround me with some folks that have the anointing on their life who can show me how to get a double portion of what you would want me to have. Y'all stand on your feet. Stand on your feet. Don't look at nobody else. Don't worry about nobody else. But if you need to do better, if you want to be better, then come down and let's pray together. If you're afraid of some things, if there are some things bothering you, if there are things holding you back,